Okay, so here we have our swatch that we're going to measure to see if we can get our gauge. Now you'll notice that this swatch is a lot bigger than the ones I had previously. For example, this here. This is basically a swatch that I did that measures roughly 4 inches. So that's what the pattern calls for. Most patterns will ask you to do a gauge that's 4 inches, but it's always a good idea to do it bigger than that. And there's a couple of reasons for that. First of all, your edge stitches in a swatch always are distorted. So you want to get a true reading of the amount of stitches that you're getting. So at the edge, they're usually maybe a little bit looser or maybe bunched together. There's always some distortion at the edges. So if you do a 4-inch swatch and then measure right from the edge, well, you're not going to get a true reading of the stitches within there because those edge stitches are going to be distorted. So you might either get your stitch count might be a little bit less because of that. So it's better to do a bigger swatch and just use stitches that are more evenly formed. You want to take your swatch from in, have enough stitches that you can take a swatch reading from inside. And two, it also gives you an opportunity to, a bigger swatch will help you determine what the drape or how your fabric is going to feel, because you can actually pick it up in your hand and let it drape over your hand, and it really gives you a better idea of how that fabric is going to behave. So larger swatches are better. So if, say, for example, the pattern tells you to do a gauge swatch of 15 stitches and 23 rows, well, then double that. Do 30 stitches and do, what is that, 46 rows. It's going to give you a bigger canvas to get a more accurate reading of your yarn. So what I like to do is I just like to place my tape measure in the middle of the swatch, and then I just mark 4 inches. So I'm going to make sure, first of all, that I'm going to start. I'll explain what I'm doing in a minute. So I'm just placing a marker or a start. This is where I'm going to place my stitch, and I've made sure that I place this pin at the beginning of a full stitch. So again, what is a full stitch in stocking knit stitch? Stocking knit stitch is made up of V's. So if you look closely at stocking knit stitch fabric, you'll see that it's just made up of hundreds of V's. Each one of those V's, so those two legs in a V shape, that's one stitch. So that's what we're going to be counting. We're going to be counting each V. It's going to be a stitch. So I'm going to place my tape measure here, and then at the 4-inch mark, I'm going to place another pin. So whatever full stitches or full V's are between here, that's going to be my stitch count or it's going to give me the amount or the it's going to tell me the width of this gauge. Now I'm going to be counting these V's above this paper line. Okay, so here's the first V. That's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. All right, so we have 15 stitches across. Now that is what our pattern called for, that we're using as a sample. So remember, our gauge swatch that the designer of that pattern wants us to get, they said for 4 inches, you should get 15 stitches across, and you should get 23 rows, or that should be the length, to make 4 inches. So now we're going to measure the rows. So we're going to do the same thing. We're going to measure a 4-inch section, and we're going to do the same idea. We're going to place a pin, and I'm going to make sure, first of all, I'm going to place a pin at the bottom or the tip of a V, because we want to measure full stitches. Okay, so that's, we're gonna place our four inch mark here, and we're gonna place the pin here. Okay, so we've measured out 4 inches. So now we're gonna count and see if we get 23. So again we're counting the V's in 4 inches. So since we've marked it, we don't need that anymore. But I'll place a piece of paper again so you can see the row that we're going to use. So again, I want to do, we're counting V's again, so how about I place the paper here, and then you can see these are the rows, or yes, these are the V's that we're going to be counting. And this is our last V here. So we count here. This is the first one. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22. Now, if you see here, I got 22 stitches, and the pattern called for 23 stitches. So is that a big deal? Now, with the width, we were spot on. We got 15 stitches, but we were 1 stitch off for the length. Now, it is important to try and get as close overall to the gauge that the pattern calls for. But you have a little more flexibility when it comes to the length of your garment, because you can adjust that as you're knitting. Now, width is a different matter, because you don't want, if you have too many stitches or too little stitches, that's gonna make your garment, especially if it's you know, if it's a scarf, that's not such a big deal. But if it's a hat, or if it's a sweater, if it's too small, it's not going to be comfortable. Conversely, if it's too wide, because you've gone over that stitch count, that's not comfortable either. It's not going to be the look that you want. So width, you really need to be quite accurate. Length, though, you can always, as you're knitting your pattern, you can always eliminate rows or add rows to compensate if you're a little bit short. So do your swatches. It's not to say that length is not important, it is, but at least you have some flexibility. If you are getting your width spot on, because sometimes when you're changing your needle sizes, you might in some cases not be able to get both gauges. You might not be able to all the time get the width and the length as the pattern that the gauge calls for. But if you can at least get the width, it's better to get that and then manipulate the length as you're knitting. So we're not going to worry about that one stitch that we're off. Now, another thing to keep in mind too is, because this is not a machine knit thing, it's knit by your hands, our work is going to vary. Sometimes some stitches, just because of the nature of doing things by hand, some stitches are not going to be as even as others, or they might be a little looser, or they might be a little tighter. Overall, when you look at your stitches, it'll look fairly even to the eye. But each individual stitch is going to have little tiny variations from the stitch next to it. So when you do a large swatch like this, another advantage is that you can take more than one gauge reading from this size swatch. So we did a gauge right in the middle. Well, maybe we want to move up a bit and do a gauge starting here and measure our width and our length here. Maybe we want to move after that, and we'll write down the measurements that we got. Maybe we'll move over here for our next measurement, and we'll do it from here and do our 4 inches down this way. So the larger your swatch, the more areas you can take different gauge readings from. And then what you can do is take the average of those measurements. That's going to give you an even more accurate gauge reading, because then you're going to know overall, well, for most of these swatches, these are the numbers I got. So that's going to be the most accurate reading. So another advantage of doing a bigger swatch, and you can even do a swatch bigger than this. A lot of designers, you know, will work from, some will even use a whole skein of yarn, just so that they can really get a sense of the drape and take a lot of swatches to be as accurate as possible, because they want you to have success in knitting their patterns as well. So that's how you measure a gauge swatch with stocking knit stitch. Now, what if the pattern you called for wants you to do a reading of reverse stocking knit stitch? So reverse stocking knit stitch is just the other side of stocking knit. So if your pattern has this as the public side or the right side, the side that's facing out that everyone's going to see, if this is your good side, well, you see all these little bumps in that. That's kind of hard to read. So you know that stocking knit and reverse stocking knit, is they're going to be part of the same fabric. So if your pattern is a reverse stocking knit stitch and you need to do a gauge reading from it, then just do the gauge from the stocking knit stitch side and save yourself a lot of problem, because you'll get an accurate reading because it's just the other side of that stitch. Garter stitch. Garter stitch is a very common stitch that a lot of patterns call for. It produces a nice, flat, dense fabric, and it's a favorite because you knit every row, so it's really easy to do. So that's a common stitch that a lot of patterns call for. So I'm going to show you how to do, or how to mark out a gauge for that. So I've done the same thing that we did with the stocking knit example of the gauge. I just marked out my 4 inches. I'm not going to count the stitches. I'm just going to show you how to read this yarn so you know what makes up a stitch in garter stitch. Because you can see that it is a different fabric than the stocking knit. The stocking knit stitch, remember, it's made up of V's. Garter stitch is not made up of V's. So how do you count these? What is a stitch? So if you look closely, you'll see these little crescent shapes. Some face downwards, and then underneath them, in this next row, the others face upwards, these crescent shapes. So most people like to refer to these as frowns and smiles. So that's an easy way to recognize this. So what you would do is you would just choose what you're going to count. You're either going to count your frowns or your smiles. So we're going to be positive, we're not going to be negative, and we're going to count that's what we're going to choose to count is our smiles, but it's up to you. So that's what you would do. Each of these smiles or crescents that go upwards, or the opposite if that's what you're counting, that's what you would count. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then you just go across. So that'll be how many stitches are across. Now your rows. How do you count the rows in garter stitch? So again, we would do the same thing. We would mark off 4 inches. So let me do that. So I'm going to place my first pin at the top of a stitch, because we're counting full stitches here. So we already know that the frowns and the smiles make up a stitch. So let's place it so that there's a smile is our first stitch right here, and I'm going to mark that. Then we're going to move down 4 inches and place our pin. So garter stitch, when it's formed, it produces these little ridges. So the two rows produce these. So you've got visible stitches on the top, but also you have stitches that are in between. So you don't really, it's kind of a pain to, it can be kind of like, well, how do you count that? So it's very easy. Instead of counting all the top stitches that you see, or trying to get in here, in between these, in these little valleys to count. All you have to remember is that garter stitch is made up of two rows that you knit. So each ridge represents two rows of knitting. That's all you have to remember. So what you're going to do is count the ridges by twos. So 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12. Because remember, the smile and the frown, those are the two rows that you did, the two knit rows. So just count your ridges. Very easy. So again, remember, stitches across, we're either going to count smiles or frowns for your stitch. Not a combination of both, just pick one or the other. Each of those, for example, each smile is a stitch. But remember, for your rows, we're going to be counting by twos. We're going to be counting the ridges. So you can see the ridge here. The ridge is combined, has those, both the smile and the frown. And then you've got this little valley in between. See that? So it's very easy to see these ridges. We're going to count those ridges. Each of those ridges are two rows. And that's how you count that.
So I wanted to take a few moments to briefly show how to knit a gauge swatch in the round. And it's important for you to do this when knitting a garment circularly, because your tension is going to be quite different than if you knit it back and forth.
So you see here we have a stocking knit stitch gauge swatch. Just like the others, I have a border of garter stitch around the edges. But when we flip the work, you'll see that it looks quite different. There are these long strands or floats that are running across the back of the work. So I'm going to explain why that's been done shortly, but first I'm going to just show how to get those floats across the back, because that's very important in doing this circular swatch. So I'm just working to the end of the row. And you're going to see shortly why those circular needles or a double pointed needle is necessary for this method. So notice that we're not going to turn the work as you would if you're working back and forth. What we're going to do is slide those stitches across to the other end of the needle. So again, this is only, you're only able to do this with either circular or double pointed needles. So all the stitches have been moved to the other end of the needle, back to the beginning. And now the working yarn that's behind, we're going to pull it across the back of the work. And making sure that it's loose enough so that it doesn't pucker the fabric too much on the front. And then just begin knitting again. And this is what's mimicking working circularly or in the round. So we're not turning the work at all. We're just sliding the stitches back to the other end when we're done a row.
pulling the yarn, the working yarn behind the work, back to the beginning, and just leaving it a little bit slack so that it doesn't bunch up our fabric. And then you just continue doing that until you reach the length that you want your gauge sample to be. So it's as easy as that. And then a little bit later on, I'm going to show you what we're going to do to manage all those floats in the back. So again, we're going to push all of the stitches to the opposite end. Pull our working yarn behind the work across to the beginning and just make sure that there's enough slack. Just stretching the gauge sample can help give enough slack on that back yarn that we've pulled across, and then continue. So now that the length has been reached of our sample, we can just finish it off. So I'm just finishing it off with a few rows of garter stitch. Now, I didn't bother working back and forth for the garter stitch, or I didn't bother knitting it circularly because it's not going to be part of my gauge count, so it doesn't really matter that that's done circularly. So I just finished it off quickly, and now I'm going to show you how we're going to manage those floats on the back so that our sample lays nice and flat so that we can get a good measurement. So you can see here, it doesn't lay flat because those floats on the back are pulling it too tightly. So we're going to solve that simply by just cutting those stitches down the center, those back floats. And that's all you have to do. Now the sample will lay flat and we can get a good measurement and an accurate measurement of our gauge that was knit circularly. So very easy to do, and I highly, highly recommend that any project that you're going to work in the round, that you do your gauge in the round, because as I mentioned before, your tension or the way that you knit is going to be very different from when knitting back and forth, because you're going to turn the work, you're going to perhaps do a different stitch on the back. For example, stocking knit stitch, you're going to knit on the front, you're going to purl on the back. So those are going to give you two different tensions. When you knit circularly, you don't turn your work, so your knitting is going to be, your tension is going to be more even because you're not changing the direction that you're knitting. So to mimic that, make sure that you knit in the round so that your gauge will really reflect how your actual finished piece will be worked. And that's how you knit a gauge sample in the round.
So what do you think? Are you convinced that gauge swatching is important? Or better yet, can you see the benefits of gauge swatching? Because really that's going to be the key. If you have a positive mindset about it, then it's not going to seem like this chore or this other thing that you have to do that's getting in the way of you just getting onto the fun stuff and getting on with the project that you're so excited about. And it's good to keep in mind that that project that you're so excited about and impatient to start, it can easily turn into a big disappointment in the end when it doesn't turn out the way that you want. So doing a gauge swatch, just look at it as a tool to success. It's going to, in the end, give you a project or an outcome that you're really going to be happy with and pleased with. And that's really what you want, because you're going to spend so much time on this project. So I hope that these series of videos on gauge have given you something useful, another tool that you can add in your toolkit to success. And hopefully everything was explained clearly and that you really do see the benefit of doing a gauge swatch, and also that you see the possibilities, because swatching is going to give you flexibility and give you some creative control over the projects that you do. So it really is something that shouldn't be looked to negatively, but really it is a positive. It's a good tool to have and a good practice to do. To do your gauge swatches, and you'll always, for the most part, be really pleased and happy with the end result. So again, if you found this tutorial useful, please subscribe to my channel so that you can be notified of other videos that I have coming up. I have a lot of other tutorials planned. You just need a little bit of patience, because editing video takes a long time and I'm very short on the time that I can spend doing these videos. But I do have some more knitting tutorials planned. I have tutorials about dyeing yarn. I have a lot of that filmed. It's just I just need to now sit down and do the editing part, and I look forward to putting those out for you. So please like, share, and subscribe. My website is essenceofautumnyarn.com. You can find me on Instagram at Essence of Autumn. I'm on Ravelry as Essence of Autumn Yarn, and Facebook, Essence of Autumn Yarn. And you can also shop on my Facebook page as well if you're interested, or just check it out. So again, thank you for watching, and until next time, bye.